led this evening by Matthew Davey. Matthew?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, please, Mrs. Meltzer.
Thank you. Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Gillingham?
Here.
Mr. Pearl?
Here.
Mr. Cannon?
Here.
Mrs. West?
Here.
Mr. Sowerby?
Here.
Mrs. Meltzer, here.
Are there any additions or deletions to tonight's agenda?
Yes, sir. There is one deletion. We're deleting item number 3. And can I request to move item 17 to 1A?
Thank you.
So moved.
Support. Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passed.
Thank you, and welcome to your Township Board meeting this evening. If you have anything to say on any item as it comes before the board, please come to the podium and clearly give us your name and address for the record. If there's an item you wish to speak to that's not on the agenda and we already have one of those filled out, we have public comment cards to your left in the front of the room. Please fill one out and we'll hear what you have to say at the end of the meeting. And with that, we'll start with item number 1, request permission to conduct the annual Clintondale Community Parade.
Dear Charter of Clinton Township Board, Clintondale High School is asking the Township for permission to have its annual community parade on Friday, October 9th, 2015. The parade will start at 4 p.m. in front of the high school in the parking lot and continue along the parade route. See the map enclosed. The police department and fire department departments have already been contacted, and for any questions, you can reach Alexander Taylor, the Clinton Township High School Student Congress Advisor.
Thank you. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
I would like to make that motion as a proud alumni.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Gillingham makes a motion, supported by Mr. Pearl. Roll call, please.
Gillingham.
There you go.
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 17, which is now 1A, is request permission to post signs throughout the township for the annual homeless veteran celebrity golf outing.
Dear Honorable Board members, I'm requesting approval by this board to place 18 by 24 inch signs on township property out of the right of way. This matter has been discussed with the superintendent of building. The purpose of the sign placement is to advertise for an upcoming fundraiser for Southeastern Michigan Veterans annual stand down golf outing. We are a nonprofit 501c3 that uses donations to pay for flu shots, dental checkups, food and clothing for homeless veterans. Over the last 3 years, we have raised more than $15,000 to support our efforts. Thank you for your attention to our request. Sincerely, Sue McFarland, Treasurer.
Thank you, and I know that we have a sample of the...
Yes, this is a sample of the sign.
You want to come right over to the...
Yes, this is the sign. It's front and back.
Okay.
And
you do this every year, and we certainly appreciate it. You do. And when they say they have celebrities, they truly have celebrities, the former football players. And I don't know how you became such good friends with so many people of such influence.
It took 2.5 hours, but I will tell you that Tim Walton, who played for Clinton a little bit before, was the one has invited Sue and myself to dinner with NFL former football players tomorrow night at Ford Field.
That's a nice thing.
Very nice.
You have some real nice signs. You obviously you raise money for those signs.
Right. Actually, we could help. Mm-hmm. Actually, Kim Meltzer donated all of these for us.
Very nice. Now, regarding signs, this past weekend we had two of our ordinance officers work on Sunday morning, 4 hours each, and they collected 200 and some odd signs that size and tons of other signs. Those signs are allowed only when the board approves it and only in areas that are not in the right of way. On the weekends, you see many people putting these illegal signs up. Mm-hmm. They don't belong there. If you see them and they're between the sidewalk and the road, there's no harm in taking them down because they are illegally placed there. All of these signs will be placed on private property or township property, not in the road right of way. It's a safety hazard. And think about this, if every business in the community were allowed to put up whatever number of signs they wanted, anywhere they wanted, what would this community look like?
Trashy.
So, but
move
for
move
us
to
this
approve.
Support.
Can I, okay, I just want to, we want to announce when this event is taking place. So it's Monday, July 27th at the Hickory Hollow Golf Course, which is on North Avenue, Macomb Township. It's their annual homeless veterans celebrity golf outing to support our homeless veterans. And if there's anybody that wants to participate, we hope there's a lot of support in this regard. You can contact Sue McFarland at 586-776-0073.
Correct.
Thank you for what you do. Yes, sir.
Bob Hogan, 36755 Bar Street. The supervisor just mentioned he had two employees out there for 4 hours this past weekend, Saturday or Sunday, picking up these signs. Is that at the township expense, or can you incur or get that money back from any of the people that you pick these signs up? They most likely have phone numbers or addresses.
Well, there's phone numbers and addresses. The problem we have, Bob, is that, first of all, we have to see them, put them there, which is number one, a difficult thing to do. We do have our ordinance officers who have written tickets. Some of those people who were putting these out illegal who continue to do it are going to be taken to court. And most likely, Barry Miller, our building department head, is here. They will be fined. Does it cover our cost? No. But does it keep our neighborhoods from being blighted? The answer is yes. So you pay for it. There's
yeah,
no doubt.
I know.
And it was trade hours. These fellows volunteered to work those hours and take hours off on a different day as opposed to overtime or anything like that.
That's fine, but it's still there 8 hours.
I understand.
Total hours. That's what I was getting
The community looks a lot nicer because of what they did this past Sunday.
I'm sure they do.
Thank you.
Mr. Cannon, can I also add, too, what that does is people that maybe we can't get in touch with them for whatever reason, however, they don't like that their signs are removed because it costs them money. So hopefully this will deter this behavior with this, at least this particular violator in the future.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Motion by Mr. Pearl, supported by?
If I may, I just to further elaborate on that, a lot of times the businesses in other communities come down and they place them throughout the township. And by doing random weekends here and there, it will hopefully get them used to the fact that they're wasting a lot of money putting these signs out there, because we're just going to take them and properly dispose of them. A lot of these businesses, they don't like to have to incur that extra cost. And not only that, I received multiple calls today asking where their signs were, and I informed them they were in our dumpster. They are permitted to come buy them back at $50 per sign, but most of them choose not to.
The motion has been made by Mr. Pearl, supported by Mr. Reynolds, to permit this. Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 3 has been deleted. Item 4, request for variance for a fence in the front yard at 18600 Clinton River Road.
Are we missing item 2?
Yes, item 2.
I'm sorry. I passed over the church. Special land use, a church in the R5 One Family Residential District and Site Development Plan for Fresh Start Community Church at Parker Elementary School.
This commission has held public hearing on the proposal for special land use being a church in the R5 One Family Residential District on the subject property located north of Quinn Road, east of Gratiot Avenue, and has made review of the request. In consideration of grant of variance by the Board of Appeals, we hereby make recommendation for approval of the special land use to permit a church in the R5 District Fresh Start Community Church at Robbie Parker Elementary School. This action was by vote unanimously. A copy of the notice of the June 25th, 2015 public hearing containing legal description and sketch of location of the land in question is attached for your information and file. This matter was petitioned by Pastor Darren Brown, Fresh Start Community Church, 34151 Vanita Street, Clinton Township, Michigan, 48035. We submit this proposal for consideration and would appreciate advisement of your determination. Sincerely, Denise Trombley, Secretary for Clinton Township Planning Commission.
Thank you. Are there any comments or questions of board members?
Can.
Mr. Sowerby?
Through the chair to probably the planning director. So this is a special request, special land use, because it's happening at Robbie Parker School.
No. It's a special land use because churches are required to have a special land use.
So is this a permanent location, or is this a request that is as a temporary location as other churches have located before in schools in the past before they ended up finding their final place to build on a permanent location?
Well, we were told it's a temporary location until they find something, but there's no end date really attached to that.
Is, through the chair, is the petitioner here? Oh, okay. Good, how are you?
Could we get your name and address for the record, please, sir?
Yes, sir. My name is Darren Brown. Address 34151 Vanita Street in Clinton Township, 48035.
Thank you.
And I am the pastor of Fresh Start Community Church.
Can you tell us about the church and what your future plans are?
Absolutely. We're a brand new church in the community, maybe April or so, May. About 30 parishioners currently. And yes, to your point, it is a temporary location till we find something more permanent. But as the gentleman just advised, we don't have an end date because we have not been able to find a more permanent location as of yet, as obviously we're still a little small church with the intent to in time grow and be able to secure a more permanent location in the Clinton Township area.
Great, thank you.
Further questions?
So it's my understanding, as reading through the materials, that you currently do not have a lease agreement with Clintondale Schools. You're waiting for approval from us, so then you can proceed with those negotiations?
Right. We have not. We have, we spoke with the zoning committee, we have a lease agreement in place, but it's not been signed because we're waiting for approval.
Okay. Well, you know, the school district is already a tax-exempt part of the township. The churches will, of course, be tax-exempt. So I think it's a nice sort of blending of, you know, the use of the property and turning what are schools into real community buildings. So I think it's a good thing to see, and it fully utilizes that building on the weekends when it wouldn't otherwise be being used. And so I wish you all the best of luck.
So much.
Okay. The floor is open for a motion.
Move to approve.
Support.
Can I just, I wanted to just clarify, churches don't really rely on luck, they rely on blessings. So.
Thank you for that correction.
And good luck.
Roll call, please, Mrs. Meltzer.
I forgot who made the motion. Did you make it, Paul?
I did.
Mr. Reynolds did.
Thank you.
That's cute. Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank
Welcome
you.
Welcome.
Nice. So much. Thank you so yep. much. Glad to be part of the community. Have a great night.
Thank you.
Yep, you too.
Item 3 has been deleted. Item 4, request for variance for a fence in the front yard on Clinton River Road.
I live at 18600 Clinton River Road, and I am requesting a waiver to allow a fence in the front yard. This is Mr. Poluski at said address, and then he has submitted another letter, which I'd like to read. To whom this may concern, this is a letter requesting permission for a fence permit in the front of the yard. My daughter and I were under the impression that we already had the permit to build a 6-foot wooden fence in the front yard. Unfortunately, there was a misunderstanding, and the fence is supposed to be around 15 feet back. I have already started to build a fence, but have not finished because I stopped immediately when I noticed of this. Due to the misunderstanding, I have already put a lot of hard work and money into it. If I tear up the fence now, the front will look awful with all the holes, cement, and yard damage left behind. In addition, it will cost even more work as well as money, and all the hard work will have been for nothing. I have been trying to build this fence for over a year now. I have spent time and money getting permits that I recently found out I don't even need. I can't build a backyard fence because of the flood zone. I went through a lot of hardships, heartaches, and headaches because of this fence. I'm asking for an opened 6-foot tall and 250-foot long open fence in the front yard. It is important for me to build this fence because this is a historical house. When they built it that close to the road, there wasn't all the traffic there is today. Also, this is the last house before the three-way stop, and often people make a U-turn in my driveway. The way the house is angled, the bright light from cars always shines onto the bedroom windows. Because of the numerous accidents, we are afraid that someone will hit the propane tank. The cars are causing airstream and debris, which is very damaging to a house so close to the road with constant traffic. I have renovated this house, and I am very proud of it, and I would like to preserve it as long as possible. People coming back from Fern Hill late at night, sometimes lost or disoriented, pulling my driveway, asking for directions. There are a lot of animals such as skunk, deer, raccoons, et cetera, coming out of the woods onto traffic. We would hope this would protect the drivers and the animals by keeping some of the animals behind the fence. If a driver is to speed out of control and hit the fence, it would slow them down and the impact wouldn't be as great. If the fence is built according to the city ordinance, it would defeat the purpose of the fence. Propane tank would stick out as well as the house. My family and the drivers passing by would not be protected. Sincerely, Piotr Poluski.
Thank you. I believe the petitioner is here. Are there any comments or questions of board members? Earl?
Yes, does planning or building have any problem with this?
Building department issued a permit previously for the fence to be located at the front edge of the home, as we have in the past. During the process of which Mr. Poluski started the building, he did start building it closer to the road, at which I stopped and informed him he was too close. It doesn't present too much of a visibility issue. However, this would be the only one, to my knowledge, which would be a privacy fence in the front yard in our community, which could be a precedent.
Basically, he can still have his fence just 15 feet further back, even with the house, instead of 15 feet closer to the road.
Does Mr. Santi have anything?
No.
Yeah.
Well, I somewhat agree with Barry, but, you know, there's other problems. You know, Clinton River Road is master planned at 43 feet, half right-of-way, which is 86 feet total. And I'm not sure it's, at the 43-foot line, it could create issues in the future if we wanted to add bike paths or sidewalks to Clinton River Road along that side. It's highly unlikely, but it's possible. Also, you know, fence in the front yard, you know, and I can understand why the petitioner is asking for it to some degree, but it also creates a visual barrier, which isn't very desirable along the roadway.
Thank you.
Further comments? Mr. Sarby?
Thank you. I went out there and visited the site with Mr. Miller, and the petitioner was there at the time. I observed what Barry explained was the problem with the fence, that Mr. Miller did explain to the petitioner early on where that fence had to be, and that was back at the front setback of the house, which, you know, would still work. But the problem where it is now is that, you know, in the years that I've been on this board, there have been many petitioners of fence variances coming before this board, and sometimes making the same request of wanting a fence in their front yard or some kind of shrubbery as blockage in their front yard. And our ordinance is very clear on that, you know, that is not allowed, and there are reasons for that. So they have been denied over the years. To make an exception now for this case, I think, sends a wrong message to all those persons that were denied before. It also sets a precedent going forward. I appreciate the hard work that the gentleman put into this, but Mr. Miller did explain where it had to be, and that should have been, you know, understood at that time. And it was no misunderstanding due to any lack of responsibility on Mr. Miller's part. But the rest of the story is this is in a very visible spot, Clinton River Road. And so, you know, we have petitioners of fence variances coming to this meeting on a regular basis. I can just see if there was a variance given for this exception because of what has already been done, as petitioners are coming down Clinton River Road from other parts of the township to come to a board meeting asking for the very same thing, how can we say no when they're passing by the very thing they're asking for? and I couldn't explain to them why we gave a variance there and not to others. And I think the floodgates will certainly open if we give this variance tonight, just because this gentleman did not understand what the planning, what the building director did explain early on where that fence had to go. So I think that, you know, he has a beautiful home, and he's done some wonderful things there. I saw what you've done in the yard, beautiful, but you knew what you bought at that location. And you put some good hard work into it, and it looks beautiful. But we do have this responsibility, this ordinance, and I think it has to be followed for, you know, future sake of what we're doing with other petitioners in the future.
Thank you. Mrs. Meltzer?
Thank you. I am curious. We have never allowed for a fence ever. Is there, Barry, would you know the history? Or Carlo? We've never allowed for it. Because I thought there was a fence in the front yard of a house that's right on Cass. It's on the north side of Cass before the, there was it Riverside Apartments. So it's right, you know, the corner house that's on Heidenreich and Cass.
Yep.
And so it's just west of there.
Right next to Riverside Apartments.
Yeah, I could have swore there was a fence in the front yard of that house. And so I'm just wondering if we haven't already granted.
The answer is yes, there is. And that fence was put in years ago, and I think at that time it was several weeks before an election. And all the politicians wanted to get their name on that fence. So they voted yes. None of the members of this board except me were on that board, and I remember it very clearly. And afterwards, we were very sorry that we did grant that fence permit.
Okay. So there's no other, I'm sorry, just
no,
for clarification.
That's the only one
there
I know.
Is no other.
Well, I mean, there may be, but not
there are way. Other fences in the front yard, but this would be, like, other than the one you're speaking of on Cass, this would be the only of an obscuring nature, yeah. And would it, that you couldn't visibly see through. There's multiple up and down Millar, but they're of wrought iron, aluminum, chain link. But this would be a first with wood,
privacy.
Other than the Cass Avenue. And that one on Cass Avenue, I believe, is just, it's maybe a couple 8-foot sections, to my knowledge, if that's the one you're speaking of.
Yeah, yeah, I've never seen any political signs on that fence.
No, no. After that first year, they didn't allow them.
Oh.
There was one other thing. I don't know if the board, if they choose not to approve this. They do have a propane tank that does stick out past the front of the house, probably about 5 or 6 feet, I'm guessing.
Not even that.
If that. And I don't know if the board would consider allowing them to jog around the propane tank to obscure that visibility. I know it would be an expense to have that tank moved back, and it would screen that. But again, it doesn't save him from having to move the fence back. But if the board is considering not approving it, maybe that's another consideration that could be given.
Thank you. Does the petitioner want to make any statements or ask questions?
Okay, like we say, this house was built in 1883, and this is a special house. And maybe she's going to explain.
I could translate. My name's Angelica. I live at 33792 Fraser.
Can you speak into the mic?
Speak a little
into the
oh,
mic
I'm sorry.
Louder. Only because I'm even
I'm
hear.
Sorry.
Ten dom był zbudowany wtedy nie było takiego trafiku jeszcze że teraz
when
się domem jak samochody przyjeżdżają.
This house at the time this house was built in what year?
1883.
There was not this much traffic. Now as cars are coming by, the whole house shakes. And it's really noisy due to the traffic, especially since there's a three-way stop sign right there. And I do understand what you guys are saying, that there's no other fences anywhere else. But because of the traffic and the location of the house, I mean, I lived there for a little bit, and the bright lights, it's really disturbing, and how loud, and it literally, if it's like a bigger car, it really does shake.
I think when that house was built, there weren't any cars.
Yeah.
Or that, yeah. And then another thing, there is a lot of houses that are fenced, and which my understanding is, as long as it's the side of the house, wherever, or the back, it's allowed. But this house is not, just because the door is right there, which we don't even use the front door there. I understand that's where the address is, but like, it's the side that we always go into. So there are a lot of fenced houses, except it's the side of them. So had this house been angled a little bit more, or had there been a road, it would have been allowed.
That's a good idea.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mrs. West?
Thank you. Through the chair, to Mr. Miller, may I ask a question? As I understand it, what you're looking at is that they need to move it back closer to the house, not that if the fence is gone completely.
That's correct. The fence can exist, but the way the ordinance is written, you may not protrude beyond the front edge of your home closer to the road than the front of the house with any type of fence at all.
Okay, so when you said it would jog around the, or dodge around, or whatever you said, around the tank, you're just basically, right?
They could do that, yes. I mean, well, actually, they could with your approval.
Right. So they could still have a fence in the front, so they could still not have the lights beaming into their house, but not as far to the street, no?
They have two windows in the very front of the house next to the front door that they could not legally cover by a fence, the way the ordinance is written. Yeah. So the window on the side would be still screened if indeed the fence was put back where it was originally approved.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I also wanted to add, not that far, approximately how many yards? 200 yards, somebody hit a tree and died. Mm-hmm. And then somebody hit a tree, the owner was telling us, right in front of the house. Mm-hmm. It's just the location of the house, and it's just hazardous, mm-hmm, and not safe where it's located. So we're hoping that the fence would slow down the impact of, God forbid, there's a more accidents to happen.
Okay. Thank you. What is the wishes of the board? Mr. Sarby?
Make a motion to deny the request, and if the, based on the recommendation of the building department director, Mr. Miller's, working directly with the property owner, if they choose to have a fence up that meets the ordinance, that Mr. Miller work directly with the owner to allow the size of the jogging around the propane tank, that it's not left to the owner to decide, but Mr. Miller works with the owner for that configuration. And so that's part of the denial, and that the owner has up to 60 days to remove the existing fence and comply with the ordinance.
I'll support that. Roll call, please, Mrs. Meltzer.
I have a question.
Okay.
Does that give them sufficient time, 60 days? Is that a regular?
More than sufficient time.
It's generally a sufficient, okay. I want to make sure.
I think 60 days would be enough time for them to start the process, at least of removing the panels from the fencing. If they needed additional time to work on the, I know they had poured some foundations in that area for those support columns.
I mean, I'm open to 90 days. I just think that they need some time to be able to put things back together. If people don't think 60 days enough, I'm happy to make it 90
removal,
days.
Your 60 days for the removal of what's there is not a problem. I mean, erecting the fence, they can take up to a year to erect a fence per permitting. So if they remove the fence within 60 days, and then they can put it back up at a time frame that works for them, I think that would be in their best interest, in our best interest as well.
So good. do you want to make that part of the motion then, that you add that it has to be erected within a year?
Well, that's just part of the
that's
the
part of a permit.
Permit.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Reynolds.
Thank you. This is if you can answer it through the chair to Mr. Miller. If they wanted to put a wrought iron fence up in the front yard, would they still need a variance, or would they be allowed to do that?
They would need to, in order to put any fence in the front yard, mm-hmm. it is at the discretion of the building official, myself. In the past, I know we have allowed them, depending on location, if they were not obscuring. Generally, I believe my predecessor had brought anything in the front yard along the right-of-way to this board.
Okay. Would the building department have an objection on that, since you can see through it? I'm only asking because I can think of numerous houses that have mm-hmm. a wrought iron fence all the way around. Oh. And that would help with some of their concerns on a car coming through. And
it's really hard for him to answer that because he would need to see exactly what that fence looks like. There's a lot of different designs. And I think a lot of the ones that he referred to on Moravian were there long before we had an ordinance against it. So, but I think that he's always been very reasonable with people coming to him with requests.
Okay, well, just throwing out an option.
Okay, well, we have a motion and a support on the floor. Further discussion?
Mr. Chairman, before you take the vote, are you amending the motion to have that extra period of time that Mr. Miller was proposing or not? Because it's
think
not
he,
clear.
I don't think
point.
He said we needed it.
We don't need it.
The 60 days. I think the 60 days would be more than enough for removal of what was installed.
I think the only word you want to make sure is in there is removal.
Yeah, that's what I said, was 60 days for the removal of okay. the existing, of what's been erected okay. so far.
That's what we have. Thank you. Roll call, please.
Okay, this is a motion to deny the request. Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion
Thank you.
Is denied.
Item 5, request permission to host a back-to-school charity event at Prince Drury Park on Saturday, August 29th from 1 till 4 p.m.
Dear Board of Trustees, I am the Elementary Children's Director at New Life Christian Church, 31700 Cuches, St. Clair Shores, Michigan 48082. At our church facility, we are currently hosting a school supply drive to collect school supplies for lower-income families in Clinton Township. We are writing to obtain permission to host a back-to-school charity event at Prince Drury Park on Saturday, August 29th from 1 to 4 p.m. Our vision for this outreach is to love and bless the lower-income families in the neighborhood surrounding the park. We would engage the community by providing ice cream, popsicles, balloon, animals, face painting, and fun back-to-school games. We would not be selling anything, as we would provide everything free of charge to the neighborhood kids. We would greatly appreciate it if you would allow us to serve the Clinton Township area and bless as many families as possible. The day of the event, we would like to put a few signs up at the park stating that we are having a free back-to-school event and would also like to use the pavilion to set up the games and the other free stations for the balloon animals, face painting games, ice cream, etc. We are requesting to use your pavilion free of charge so that we can use those designated finances to provide more supplies to each family in Clinton Township. We will not be setting up any bounce houses or tents. We have reached out to Parker Elementary and asked that the needs in the school are so that we can help meet those needs directly. We would also have printed invites available for kids to take, if desired, inviting them to our children's church the following Sunday, where we will be doing a back-to-school series on Sunday mornings through the month of September from 10 a.m. to noon. This series is focusing on good behavioral characteristics that are useful in school, such as kindness, courage, obedience, etc. We truly appreciate your time. We have hope that we can partner with you to bring kindness and cheer to the area. Much appreciation. Carrie Shearer, Children's Director, New Life Christian Church.
Thank you. Is the petitioner here this evening? Thank you.
My name's Michael Malloy. Carrie is actually at our children's ministry camp, so she couldn't be here. I'm here in her place. I'm the lead pastor of New Life Christian Church.
Thank you. Are there any comments or questions of board members? Mrs. West?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Have you by any chance reached out to Ebony over at the Clinton Township Public Housing or Sid Lucas? Those are two people who are very active in that area and would be very helpful.
You know? No, that's wonderful. I'm not sure. Okay. Carrie has been handling that. So.
Okay.
But what were those names again?
Ebony Nugent, N-U-G-I-N. And she is the executive director at the public housing. And Sid Lucas is also on the board there. So if you called Ebony, you could actually, you know, get a hold of Sid. We have a house, we have a public housing meeting the third Thursday of every month over at Village Road. So it would be great. They have one this Thursday, and then they would have one, you know, a week before your event.
And where was that meeting at?
It's on Village Road off of 15 Mile. It's the public housing area. And I think that there's a lot of those school children who are in there could
really, really would be.
And we have a community building there.
All right.
So maybe if, heaven forbid, you get rained out here, you could have something there.
No, that'd be wonderful.
Okay.
No, I appreciate that.
So, yeah,
that.
Call
Thank
them. And if worst case scenario, you forget all those names or it just call the township and ask for me.
No, thank you.
Do we know if the date's available for this? Has it been checked on?
No. Did you check with our...
I believe that she has contacted, but again, I cannot confirm that for sure.
Okay. I'm moving to approve it as long as the date's available.
Additional on the date, sure.
Mr. Cannon?
Mr. Sarby?
Okay. But the issue before us, and what sounds like a wonderful event, Pastor, and certainly welcome it, but... We have a policy, and we've had many other groups come before us asking for the fee to be waived. And the fees do not get waived for any, whether nonprofit or whatever the event. It's, I think, $100 to rent the pavilion. I don't know, but we've never waived the fee. Sometimes charitable organizations or whatever, or, you know, other groups will provide the cost to help out the organization for the event, but you know, I don't know why nobody's bringing that up, but
I was going to bring it up.
Case good. Okay. But we don't, and so if that's part of the motion is you know, if you aren't,
yeah, I didn't mention the fee anyway.
Okay, well, that was part of the event.
And maybe the Optimus or some other group can help them with the fee.
Mrs. Meltzer?
Well, I was just going to mention what Mr. Sowerby mentioned, that we don't approve on, you know, non-payment. So we just wish you the best, though, and hope
that you
can maybe find some donations throughout the community or even as a result of having it on the board agenda here and speaking publicly. Maybe somebody will come forward to help you with that cost.
Or you could look over at Village Road.
All right, very good.
There you go.
Going to be helping a lot of those. And we have a lovely, don't jump back, Jack. We have a lovely area where the kids can play, too. So, and I think that they would love that. And if there's a fee for that building, I will personally pay for it.
No, I appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Okay. My husband loves it when I do that.
Do we have a motion on the floor?
I made a motion. Nobody seconded it yet.
I'll second it.
To approve.
Seconded by Mr. Sowerby.
Somebody making the donation for the cost of it.
Without the fee being waived.
Without the fee being waived, right.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Hold on 1 second.
Mr. Cannon, I'd ask if he can meet with me shortly after so we can get the process started, because he needs to reserve the date officially on our calendar.
That would be good. When we're done here, just right around the corner with Mrs. Bednar.
Do we know that it's available?
It is available, but I still need to have all the paperwork filled out properly and all that good stuff.
I'll contact you tomorrow if you have an appointment.
Let me run and grab my card and I'll grab it.
All right. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Item 6, request permission to host bingo at Memory Room on Hall Road.
Hi, my name is Terry Luby. I'm a volunteer for Detroit Animal Welfare Group. We are a nonprofit, non-kill animal rescue. We are a 501c3 organization. On August 11th, 2015, we are having a Meal Lovers Bingo at the Memory Room located at 20690 Hall Road in Clinton Township. During the Meal Lovers Bingo, our players will win a package of meat and a one side to go with their meat they choose. We will also have 3 to 4 baskets to raffle off during the bingo. Thank you for taking the time to consider our rescue for the bingo license. If you have any further questions or concerns, you can contact us. Once again, thank you for your time. Terry Luby, DAWG volunteer.
A dog.
Now,
It's dog.
Okay, D-A-W-G. Dog volunteer, yes.
Sorry.
That's all right. It's appropriate. So they do submit their, I'm sorry. Okay. They have submitted their status of 501c3, and they did also submit a letter that from Vincent Serio, who's the owner of the Memory Banquet Hall in Clinton Township, and it just leaves blank, though, that says our facility will be used for a free charity event for, and then it's blank on blank, and then if you have any questions, don't hesitate to contact me. It gives his name, best regards, Vincent Serio, the member of the Memory Room, LLC. However, he has not signed it, so I think that's an issue. I also think, I'm not aware of their license that they have, and so really, I talked with them beforehand. They're here if they'd like to come forward, and ask them to possibly, maybe we can help them with the process and maybe bring this back to the board when they're more prepared, and then, you know, we're here to help you with that process and if answer any questions you might have. But after he talks to you, after the chairman.
We're ready for your comments.
We're both new to the fundraising part of dog rescue. We've both been fosters, but we just took over, you know, working and trying to raise funds for the rescue. So as you read, and this is Terry, in her letter, you know, we saw on the Macomb page about the Memory Room offering to use their facility for nonprofits, so we contacted them. So what I hear from the letter is we need to get back with them about their letter that they sent in and get the signature and the date and everything on that for us. And then you mentioned something about a license that we need besides the approval here.
Well, you're having a bingo, so you're having it's gambling, so you'll need to contact the state. And Jack, attorney.
Yeah, that's basically okay. It takes a few days to get it.
You can
have some of this, and we can talk to our director. We aren't really sure at this point, but if you can.
Right. I mean, I would suggest that you speak to your director, but otherwise, the state website provides information on bingo. So I think what's really being suggested is that you come forward with the specific dates and times, with the completed documentation, rather than just having it in blank, and. You know, give us information on the license that you're seeking, the duration of it, and so on.
Okay, is there a motion to postpone?
Mm-hmm. What? So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Postpone to date uncertain?
No, to the next board meeting, which
next
is
board meeting?
The okay. 27th, I believe.
And we're postponing it for why?
To get their paperwork
they
done.
They don't have everything they need.
They need a license, and they need permission from the owner of the establishment.
Okay.
We'll postpone until July 27th, and I did speak with you about that. That's going to work for you guys?
Yes.
It's still in time before your August 11th event.
Okay.
Hey, roll call, please.
Well, we only have a motion. Wes,
who supported?
Okay, thank you.
If they're, since they're a nonprofit, and I support, I know several businesses that donate that might pay their license fee. I can give you the names. I'll give you my card. You can call me tomorrow, and they'll pick up your fee because that's what they do for animals.
Oh, great. Perfect. Thank you very much.
Good. Roll call, please.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes.
Thank you. And item 7, approval of outdoor liquor license activity application for Fern Hill Entertainment.
Dear board members, the applicant Fern Hills Entertainment LLC, located at 17400 to 17600 Clinton River Road in Clinton Township, at Michigan 48038, has successfully com- com- complied with the requirements of the State of Michigan's liquor license application and renewal, as well as approval from this honorable board. In addition to the request for a transfer of a Class C liquor license previously approved, they are requesting approval for an outdoor liquor sales permit. All fees for this permit have been paid. Thank you for your attention to this matter. Sincerely, Kim Meltzer.
Thank you. Are there any comments or questions? The floor is open for a motion. Mr. Pearl?
Yeah, I reviewed all the paperwork. It seems in order. It is in order, in fact. I'll move to approve the request.
Support.
Further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 8, appointment to the Economic Development Corporation.
Dear board members, two terms are open on the Economic Development Corporation. These openings were advertised according to board policy. One term, currently held by Mr. Albert Calwart, is up for reappointment. He is seeking reappointment of another six-year term until July 10, 2021. The additional term is open due to the resignation of Ms. Shirley Mast, with expiration on July 10, 2016. Mr. Charles Larson has submitted his application for appointment to this vacated position. His application was previously sent to you for your review. This appointment falls under the jurisdiction of the Township Supervisor and is subject to the approval of the Township Board. Thank you for your attention to this matter. Sincerely, Debbie Stoller, Administrative Aide.
Thank you. I'll make a motion to appoint Mr. Al Calwart and Mr. Charles Larson to the terms listed here.
Support.
Roll call? I'm sorry. Roll
call? Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Number 9, approval of agreement with the Fire and Police Retirement System.
Dear board members, the Board of Trustees of the Clinton Township Fire and Police Retirement System is entrusted with the administration and operation of the system in accordance with various state statutes. Historically, the day-to-day administrative responsibility for the system has resided with a part-time hourly administrative assistant working directly for the board and paid for entirely by the system. After a recent review of the assigned responsibilities and requirements of the administrative assistant, the board has determined that the hours worked and the skill set required justify creating a full-time managerial position. In doing so, the board voted to create an executive director position with concomitant pay and benefits. For various legal and practical reasons, however, the pension system is not in a position to act as the employer in this case. As such, it is requesting the township agree to create an executive director position for the pension system with exclusive supervisory control residing with the Fire and Police Pension Board. The pension system will reimburse the township for all costs associated with the employment of an executive director. I have prepared an agreement between the township and the Fire and Police Retirement System that establishes a framework by which the executive director is a township employee with all costs and control residing with the Fire and Police Retirement System. I'm requesting board authorization to enter into said agreement, and a copy is attached for your review. Should you have any questions regarding this matter, please contact me at your convenience. Sincerely, William Smith, Human Resources Director.
Thank you. Are there any comments or questions? The floor is open for a motion.
Well, actually, I might have one question.
Mrs. West?
Through the chair, Mr. Smith, would this be very much like what we have with Ebony over at the town, you know, over the Housing Commission?
No, this is different than that. Ebony is actually an employee of the Housing Commission.
Okay.
We act as a third-party administrator for the Housing Commission when it comes to payroll and certain other aspects, but okay, those are separate employees.
Would this person fall under, like, the non-represented,
yes,
a non-represented unit? Because I know that she does, too, whenever there's a change in anything, even though she's a... She does, too. It's
convoluted. I believe
the
Housing Commission has actually adopted by reference the non-represented pay and benefits policy.
Okay.
But that's a separate matter, not actually influenced by this board.
Okay. So this would be a non-represented
position, yes.
Position, okay.
And the next item on the agenda establishes that.
I'm saying, sorry.
The next item on this agenda establishes
this
position.
I forgot about that. Yeah. Never mind.
All right.
But to be clear, her salary and benefits compensation package is set by the Retirement Commission?
Well, it'll be set by the policy itself. The amount that the policy is being amended is what the Police and Fire Pension Board preferred to pay the executive director's position.
Okay, and so future decisions on compensation would come as a recommendation then again to the board? Or
yes.
Would they occur normally throughout the course as non-represented employees are compensated?
It'd be both.
Okay.
Typically, as you'll see in the next agenda item, I have the salary adjusted per the policy that the board has adopted. But if the Police and Fire Pension Board at some point wanted to pay that executive director differently, it would come as a recommendation from that board to the township.
Okay. So assuming no changes or recommendations from the Police and Fire Pension System Board, then the rules that would apply to all of the other non-represented employees would apply to this position?
Exactly. Okay. This person will be an employee of the township.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, do you want me to ask about the salary part later? Right.
Yes.
Under that? Okay.
Yes.
If I can further, this is just, the pension system has changed tremendously since Beth Lowe became the administrator of the system. And our prior person was a part-time basis who had been there for 20 years, was a retired firefighter, and served the system wonderfully for years. But, you know, the process is changing with a lot of pension systems. And we found that we needed to have a full-time person that was willing to take on all of the necessary work that is required for this now with a system that is $110 million, with more and more retirees coming into it. It just requires a lot more skill sets. It also will mean that Beth Glow will take on some of the work that Donna Loretti and the finance department is currently doing on behalf of the pension system. So Donna will be working with Beth Glow to take on that additional work. And so that will allow then Donna and her staff to do other things in the coming years than just focusing on that. There will still be a lot of hands-on in the finance department as it's related to all of the need of police and fire and auditing and this and that and working with the auditors, but Beth Glow will take on a lot more responsibility in the coming months now she's going to have a full-time position. And we fully reimburse and always will for that position. It's basically what most of the larger pension systems all across the state and in southeastern Michigan have done.
From a technical standpoint, this was really designed, in addition to moving from part to full-time, it was designed to make it legally possible for this person to be an employee. The pension system's not really in a position to act as employer. They don't have an employer identification number. They don't have different processes set up with the state for unemployment, for workers' compensation, for all those types of issues. And so it's we worked through a process by which it became apparent that it was the best method for addressing all those issues was to make this person a township employee.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the
support
creation of the system.
Thank you.
Roll call, please.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Item 10, approval to amend to non-represented pay and benefits policy.
Dear board members, implementing the recently ratified agreement between the township and the fire and police retirement system requires the township create a retirement system executive director position. To this end, I am requesting the board approve the following pay scale amendment to the non-represented employee pay and benefits policy, executive director, fire and police retirement system. In the year 4-1-2015, salary will begin at $52,000. At 4-1-2016, salary will be $52,520. And in the year 4-1-2017, salary would be $53,308. All pay and benefits plans outlined in the policy shall apply to the newly created position. Please let me know should you have any questions regarding this matter. Sincerely, William Smith, Human Resources Director.
Thank you.
And just if I could, so then the police and fire pension system will be making an annual, a monthly, a quarterly contribution?
I believe it's a quarterly adjustment, as they do now.
And full cost enumeration? the salary, the benefits directly from pension to Clinton Township Finance.
No skimping.
Just like, just again, I'm sorry, didn't mean to, just again, like what we do with public housing for all of our employees over there. I'll make a motion to approve.
Support.
Did you have a question?
No, that's, Bill answered it earlier.
Roll call, please.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
And continuing with this example, item 11, approval of appointment to executive director.
Dear members of the board, the Fire and Police Pension Board is requesting the appointment of Ms. Elizabeth Glow to the position of executive director. Ms. Glow has worked with the retirement system since November 2013 as the administrative assistant. Ms. Glow's salary will be $52,000 as specified in the non-represented employee's pay and benefits policy. Upon Township Board approval, her first day of employment with the Township will be July 14, 2015. Thank you for consideration of this matter. Sincerely, William Smith, Human Resources Director.
Is there a motion to approve?
Move to approve as presented.
Is there a second?
Support.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 12 is recommendation from the Tax Forfeiture Committee regarding the Macomb County tax reverted properties.
The Macomb County Treasurer's Office notified us of 31 parcels that have been forfeited because of non-payment of taxes. The following is a breakdown of the parcels. 21 vacant parcels, 7 single-family homes, and 3 condominium units. The township's cost to have the 31 parcels transferred to township ownership is $125,695.97. We have attached a listing of the parcels and aerial maps showing the locations of the vacant parcels, single-family homes, and condominiums, as well as photos of the home and condos. We were not able to inspect the interior of any of the properties. At this time, the Tax Forfeiture Committee is requesting Township Board approval to purchase from the county all the tax forfeited properties with the following conditions: waiving the water fees that were accumulated to date, directing the water department to shut off the water that is active on all properties, request the assessor to review all of the properties in the 2015 tax forfeited list and make a recommendation back to the Tax Forfeiture Committee as to which properties should be removed from the 2016 tax roll. Number 4, request DPW and the building department to visit each property with a dwelling on it and to conduct an assessment of any issues such as interior exterior cleanup, demolition needs, and general securing of the property, including changing keyed entryways. And number 5, direct DPW to determine utility issues such as disconnecting electric or requesting electric be turned on for sump pump issues. And finally, number 6, request the Tax Forfeiture Committee to reconvene at a future date for a recommendation of how to dispose of these tax foreclosed properties. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact Mr. Bill Sowerby or myself. Cordially, Carlos Santia, Director of the Department of Planning and Community Development.
Thank you. Any comments or questions? Mr. Pearl?
Just a comment that one of these homes needs to be taken down right away. We have a lot of complaints. So we were waiting for this recommendation to come before us. I hope we can move on that quickly.
Sounds good. Bill?
Well, that's, and there may be another one as well in a similar condition. And Mr. Miller has a plan for that. He can probably best speak to it.
Yeah, at this time, once we have the properties rekeyed and DPW will be going into a number of structures. We have four that are of concern with which I'll go through and make the determination, bring it back to the Tax Foreclosure Committee and go forward with hopefully going for a bid for all at one time as to save taxpayer dollars and not take down one at a time. It would be more beneficial to us to take down multiple at one time than to do one at a time. And we do plan on taking these down as quickly as possible.
Okay, good. Thank you. Appreciate it.
And I think that's Mr. Pearl's point, is that the one property on Ratty that is burned has been a problem for the neighborhood and eyesore for some time, and we're anxious to have that taken down as soon as possible.
Thank you.
Mr. Gilliam?
Okay, and in the interest of full disclosure, and this comes up every year, but I want to make it very clear to my colleagues on the board and to the members of the public that I do work for the Macomb County Treasurer's Office. I have a direct impact in the parcels that you actually see here on the list. It's a service that is provided by the Macomb County Treasurer's Office on behalf of local communities for the collection of delinquent taxes. Basically, it comes down to two choices. The Treasurer's Office is responsible for collecting the tax or for closing on the property. Now, as you may have read in the Macomb Daily, Mr. Wabi goes through great efforts in ensuring that we do not foreclose on properties that are owner-occupied in the instances where it can be avoided. We start on a countywide basis with 30,000 properties coming to the county for collection. We are now countywide finalized that list down to about 400 properties. The process basically works like this, and I think it's an important point to mention because it speaks to the value of the efforts of this community in how they handle these properties. The option for local communities is, well, rather for the Treasurer's Office, they have to either take these properties that are eventually foreclosed on to auction, or they offer first right of refusal to local communities. The Treasurer's Office encourages local communities to take these properties, and the reason why is because you have the ability then to be, we, I should say, have the ability to be self-directed in what happens with them. Now, Clinton Township has put together a phenomenal program. There was a presentation made at the Treasurer's Breakfast that highlighted what Clinton Township does. They serve as a model, and we wanted to highlight the efforts of Clinton Township in how these properties are handled, how local communities can use this to their advantage. And so with that, it's been determined that I do not have a conflict of interest in voting for this, but I want to make sure that it's publicly disclosed that I do have a hand in determining the properties that are on this list here at the direction of Mr. Wabi.
So you stand to make nor lose any money on this deal. You have acted as a very conscientious board member, and on behalf of our board, you can thank Mr. Wabi for the work that he and the staff do, because you saved a lot of people from being put on the street, a lot of people, and given them every opportunity to make good. And then we as a board, along with our very qualified staff, have made sure that we put these properties back in a good order so that we do stabilize neighborhoods. So with that, I'll accept a motion to approve.
So moved.
Support.
Further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 13, request approval to pay 2015 association membership for the Traffic Safety Association of Macomb County.
This is in the amount of $2,903.88, which is the same as last year. It's based on the population at 3 cents per person.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Supported by Mr. Reynolds. Roll call, please.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 14, request to rescind board approval of the elimination of the office clerk 2 position, which represents one half for the trustee's office and one half for the supervisor's office, as recommended at the board meeting of June 29th, 2015.
Dear Honorable Board members, we request that you rescind the Board of Trustees' approval of the elimination of the Office Clerk 2 position, which represents half of a position for the trustee's office and a half position for the supervisor's office, as recommended at the board meeting of June 29, 2015, which was item number 8. On June 29, 2015, the Board of Trustees did not follow the recommendation of the Personnel Vacancy Review Committee and voted 4-3 to eliminate the shared position of the Office Clerk 2 position in the trustee's and supervisor's office. This position has been in existence since 1988 and was solely utilized as a full-time staff person in the trustee's office. It was only modified temporarily due to the economic conditions of the recession. In 2010, this position, continuing under the direct supervision of the administrative aide, became a shared position with the supervisor's office as agreed upon. It was incorrectly stated at the board meeting that this position was not eliminated, but shifted to senior staff secretary position in the supervisor's office and was cost neutral. The senior staff secretary position was being reinstated because of the memorandum of understanding between the Charter Township of Clinton and UAW Local 412, Unit 52 Technical Office Professional Employees. This was due to the fact that the supervisor had reinstated the position of the deputy supervisor and had nothing to do with the office clerk 2 position. The clerk 2 position was eliminated by the Board of Trustees without any job study being performed. There was no economic reason for the position to be eliminated, and it was done so without it being on the board agenda. Elimination of this position in this way puts the township at risk for a grievance to be filed. We request that the Board of Trustees rescind their motion from the board meeting on June 29, 2015, item number 8, and approve the recommendation of the Personnel Vacancy Review Committee and reassign the office clerk 2 position shared by the supervisor's office and the trustee's office to the trustee office exclusively. Thank you for consideration. Dean Reynolds, trustee. Jennifer Joey West, trustee with attachments. And with that, this is the memorandum of understanding between the Charter Township of Clinton and UAW Local 412, Unit 52, Technical Office Professional Employees regarding bargaining unit work in the Township Supervisor's Office. It is hereby agreed between both parties that UAW Local 412, Unit 52 work in the Supervisor's Office may be performed by the assistant to the supervisor on a temporary basis due to dire economic times. It is hereby agreed that the work will return to Unit 52 when the economic climate improves. In witness thereof, whereof, the parties have caused this memorandum of understanding to be executed by their duly authorized representatives on this 28th day of October 2010. And it is signed by William Smith, Human Resources Director, and April Bell, at that time was the chapter chairperson of the UAW Local 412 Unit 52.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a PowerPoint presentation tonight that Mr. Reynolds and I put together. I have some, you can take one, that's for you so that you can, and if there's anybody in the audience that would like one, I do have it here that you're more than welcome to have. First of all, before we go any farther, I just wanted to say that I know that there's a few corrections in here. I've noticed that there's some numbers that aren't quite right, which I will point out to you pretty much during the presentation. But at the same time, if I could get the questions at the end, the whole reason for this PowerPoint is really to help the board make an informed decision, because at the last meeting, I really felt we were a bit throwing things out there and we really weren't giving the real true facts. So. Mr. Smith, thank you. Just wanted to give a real brief, that's pretty darn small, I guess, when you put it up there, brief history. This all started with the budget meeting back in at the end of February, where there was an approval made to hire a deputy supervisor. In April, there was the meeting to approve the deputy supervisor position with a starting salary of $68,000, which was a budget increase of about $22,000. In June, the UAW Local 12, Unit 412, excuse me, Unit 52 submitted a grievance stating that the senior staff secretary needed to be reinstated per that memorandum of agreement of understanding, I should say, that the clerk just read. On June 29th, the senior staff secretary position was approved for the supervisor's office with a new position and a budget increase with benefits of about $74,000. That was what was given as an approval for, by the Personnel Vacancy Review Committee, along with the approval of the Clerk 2 to go solely and fully over to the trustees. At that time, the elimination of Clerk 2, the shared position, was totally eliminated, and that's what brings us here to today. Mr. Smith? Some of the slides here are from Mr. Cannon's State of the Township address, which I have to say were very, very well received. And I do really have to say that they're. Stay there. We didn't really get to this point as a community of excellence without a team effort and without a group of people really putting everything together. And that's all the way going back to. What's happened? That goes all the way back to 1988 when we had the clerk, and all the way back to when Mrs. Hosey was hired as our trustee administrative aid to the trustees. The whole reason there was an administrative aid was so that we would all get the information that we needed to make informed decisions. Now, there you go. One, in this slide actually came from Mr. Cannon's presentation this year, where he really talks about the points of pride. We are nearly 100,000 people who call us home, and we are the largest township in Michigan and the 10th largest community. So it isn't something that can be done very easily. Now, you can, please. Part of the history, too, is that we, as the administrative aide, and again, I know the print is small, but this comes directly from the job description. Two things I want to point out is one of them, the main things is the fact that this administrative aid to the trustees will be a communication between the board, department heads, township employees, and the general public, with trying to present us, the trustees, the four trustees, and the whole entire board in a very, very good and positive way. Some of the duties that she has is to attend all the staff meetings and actually to take minutes and take notes, schedule and attend staff meetings, et cetera. And I'm going to go through some of those staff meetings here in a moment. But if you do note, when you look at the hours of staff meetings that the administrative aide will be attending, that means with the elimination of the clerk too, that leaves the trustee's office uncovered. There's nobody there. Please. Nice picture, Mr. Sowerby. Good staff. I'm pointing this out because one of the main meetings that we have, and you can go to the next one, Bill, is the Budget, Ways, and Means meeting. This meeting, Mr. Sowerby chairs this meeting. The administrative aide takes minutes. It's usually about 2 hours on the second Tuesday of every month she would be out of the office. There's some pre-meeting agenda, gathering of information, supporting materials, contacting a community or business member who might be there, who needs to be there, getting the materials distributed, the budget, et cetera. During the meeting, she would take the minutes, and then after the meeting, distribute them, hold agenda spots on the clerk, you know, through the clerk's department for the board meeting, compose letters, include all the backup material, get everything, and on an average of a two-hour meeting, that would equal about 8 hours of uninterrupted time to complete all the tasks assigned. Now, if you really look at it, being in a service industry like we are, you never get an uninterrupted time. So if you put all those times together, it's 8 hours or so. But when you really look at it in total, it's going to take much longer than that. Next slide, please. Another major point of pride is our public services department. And there's another meeting that, you can continue on. There's another meeting that our administrative aide works with, and that's the Water and Sewer Committee. There have been 7 meetings over the past 14 months. Now, you're probably wondering why it's 14 months. It's because our administrative aide has been in that position for about 14 months. Average meeting time is about an hour and a half, again, out of the office. But due to the complexity of the meeting topics, it sometimes takes approximately 2 hours to complete the minutes and distribute. For each water sewer meeting, you're looking at about 4 hours of, again, uninterrupted time. Next, please. I think also, too, we still have refuse committee meetings, I don't see, and I believe I'm missing the refuse committee meeting, and I'm sorry about that. Again, another point of pride, we really have a great Parks and Rec department along with our Senior Adult Life Center. And this is, even as the quote, what a perfect quote, a community is often judged by how well it treats its young and older populations. Next slide. Parks and Rec Committee is a big committee for, the administrative aide. There's about 2 meetings a year, but they usually take place during January to June. There's a lot of pre-meeting work, developing the agenda, contacting committee members, contacting the school. Meetings are about an hour and a half long. They are off-site. Total time away from the office is usually 2 to 2.25 hours. Takes probably an hour to complete the minutes. Total time and needs of a Parks and Rec Committee is about 4 hours. Just a note, the administrative aide, and I must say, the clerk too, our current clerk two, does not request any reimbursement of mileage when attending off-site meetings or doing any of the other running around that they need to do for some of their jobs. The next one, and Parks and Rec obviously is with the Parks and Rec Department. The transportation meeting is something that really helps the senior population in Clinton Township. It's truly a point of pride. We distribute smart tickets to seniors so they can get not only from place to place, but also our smart buses will pick them up to take them to dialysis, et cetera. So very, very important committee. Doesn't meet often, but when it does meet, they can get rather lengthy because of some issues. But the committee members do include senior center director and assistant director, treasurer, finance director, trustee representative, which is me, smart bus representative, MedStar, and the administrative aide. Next, please. Again, we just spoke about the tax foreclosed home sales. And again, this is just as Mr. Gillingham just said, we're used as a community that is a point of pride. Next, please. The meetings are called as necessary. There have been four meetings in the past 15 months. Meetings are typically an hour and a half in duration with about an hour to complete minutes. Pre-meeting can be I misspoke here. This is one of those mistakes. It really shouldn't have been agenda. It's really a matter of notification back to the committee members. And I get into the jargon of agenda and I'm off on a roll. Estimated time for this committee is usually about 4.5 hours per meeting, from start to finish to minutes to et cetera. Next, please. Lovely picture of Mr. Pearl here. The Heritage Estates Renovation, Heritage Estates Committee. Next. Meetings are scheduled as necessary. There have been three meetings in the past 14 months. Again, pre-meeting is all the way from agenda to pulling together the supportive materials to contacting committee members, businesses, et cetera. Usually minutes are 45 minutes in duration. Obviously, Mr. Pearl likes to have quick. Approximately 30 minutes to complete the minutes, and again, these are about 2.5 to 3 hours. The Building Committee, also equally as nice a picture of Mr. Miller. He looks over, what? There have been three meetings in the past 14 months. Again, pre-meeting and agenda, all the same, pretty much the same things have to take place. Sometimes contacting community and business members can become a nightmare. You can't get a hold of them or whatever, and you end up playing phone tag more than anything else. But during the meeting, again, taking minutes, completing the minutes, and distributing. Next. Other duties for the administrative aide. And I know that we're sitting here talking tonight about the clerk too, and well, I'll get to that here in a little bit, but the other duties that are very important for the administrative aide are just, again, like on the agenda tonight, the economic development, getting those committee appointments out there. As much as they aren't overly taxing, they are very, very, very much time consuming, and making sure that they are contacting the committee members to let them know that they are their time is expired or whatever, distributing applications, getting it back to the board members, et cetera. And then maintaining the office for the trustees and assisting the trustees with township business. And number one, and most important, is public relations. That's a huge part of that job. So those are all the things to do. That's the inner workings. That's what makes the community of excellence for Clinton Township. That's the backbone. And that the administrative aide does a lot of that backbone. And in the past, past year, Mr. Cannon's stated that Township not only referred to Clinton Township as the community of excellence, but it also referred to it, next slide, please, that this is something we want to build. We want to build the building of a community of good neighbors. And the next little part of what I'm going to do is really going to talk to that point. What makes Clinton Township a community where we like to live, work, play, and pray? What are our points of pride? Next. The first one, again, this was talked about at the State of the Township, is the Festival of the Senses and the Yasu Sister Cities program. I have to share a short little story. I was just recently up at Boyne Falls for actually the Morel Festival, and I'm walking around this little art fair thing that they had, and somebody said, well, where do you live? And I said, Clinton Township. All of a sudden, there are four or five of the artists are there going, are you kidding me? I love the Festival of the Senses. That thing is awesome. And they're going on and on. Pretty soon people are talking, and the next thing you know, somebody's making a reservation to be here during that time. And I'm just standing there going, oh, they said it was Clinton Township. So it's really quite the, you can go to the next slide. So these are some of, this is some of the information and what they need to do. I've put the clerk to, some of the clerk to things in italics. But there's a major involvement, time involvement, from January to October. There are five meetings per year, 1.5 hours per meeting, approximately an hour to do minutes, and the phone calls are made by the clerk, too. That is the whole entire committee. That doesn't look at the artists who want to, you know, come in and meet. That doesn't look at the vendors who have to meet. That doesn't look at anything like that. So this does take a lot of time. And you know, when you look down at the bottom where it's got the event and the time that they spend, plus overseeing the festival the weekend of, problem solving, interacting with the artists, food vendors, entertainments, resolving issues, I've actually seen the administrative aide and clerk finding toilet paper to take into the bathrooms. I mean, they do everything. And to quote my dad, which I have to do, many hands make light work. And that event would not take place without those hands. Next slide, please. This really is a pride of the community, because if you look at it, there's zero budget impact to the general fund. And actually, to date, the Festival of the Senses has a healthy fund balance of almost $30,000. Sponsorship and vendor fees pay for all of the township services. Police, fire, DPW, everything is paid for. Multiple community benefits, community businesses, excuse me, and organizations are involved, which makes it a truly wonderful, wonderful event. If you ever can look at in the next slide, which even though how small it is, you're going to see the number of different people that they have to contact. But since 2007, the Festival of the Senses has donated $30,000 to local organizations, and I've listed them right there. As I said, this one is pretty small, but you can see there's Rizzo, there's Fern Hill, there's Scotty's Potties, there's all of those places that if they weren't contacted and contacted again, and if they weren't didn't have all of the fingers and the time spent with it, we wouldn't get this done. Other duties that happen post Festival of the Senses is all the way from the email inquiries to coming in front of here to this board to order the plaques and to present them to the sponsors and to say thank you. Thank you for making Clinton Township a place where you want to live, work, play, and pray. Thank you. And without that, they wouldn't come back the next year. Now, the next slide shows some of the duties that are directly done by the clerk, too. All the way from updating the website to processing some of the monies and get it from the artists, to assigning the artists spaces, and to probably number one, the day of and the day before and all the way through, is to actually work with maybe disgruntled artists or, you know, try to troubleshoot that. Not an easy job. The next one is actually the Yasu Cities, Sister Cities program. This was actually signed back in 1993, memorandum of understanding was signed. This is our 22nd year. The administrative aide serves as a treasurer, which requires all banking matters, preparation of all the taxes, preparation of annual reports, and attending the meetings, as well as events when the visitors are in town. Duties of Clinton Township when they host goes all the way from writing the letters for donations from various businesses to coordinating with all of the different offices, all of the different groups, so those visitors can see really what Clinton Township's all about, to actually, getting them back to the airport. These duties are split between the administrative aide and the clerk, too. And if you go to the next one, you can see that when they host Clinton Township, if it wasn't for the fact that we assist the participants with the necessary documentation and help coordinate them going over there and making sure that they know that all they have to do is pick up the phone if there's a problem over there and Clinton Township is standing behind them. Again, if you go to the next one, points of pride. Sister City Agreement was signed in 1993. 100 of Clinton Township residents have visited Yazoo City since the inception, and we've had more than 150 people here. Other Clinton Township committees that are involved with the program are the Cultural Diversity Committee, the Historical Commission, and now a new one, the Welcoming Clinton Township. I'm a little upset that I unfortunately had to be in Atlanta last week, because I hear the 10,000 visitors that came here for the fireworks made it pretty amazing. But this is another one of those points of pride. This is a collaborative program with Trustee Dean Reynolds and the Parks and Rec Director and Department, along with the Trustee's Office. Meetings usually take place during the lunchtime and usually at one of the sponsoring restaurant vendors. Trustee Reynolds really secures the sponsors, while the administrative aide and clerk too do all of that pre and post paperwork. I would hate to see a big spark fall on somebody's house and then find out that there was a missing insurance policy. I don't think Mr. Dolan would like that very much. The trustee also really coordinates with police, the fire, public works, MedStar, and all of the other departments, and along with our neighbors, securing parking because of an event, 10,000 in this area, that's pretty big. The administrative aide and clerk too also do all the post-event duties, payment, thank you letters, the board meeting, making the, again, bringing the sponsors up here to say thank you for making Clinton Township the place you want to live, work, play, and pray. Our employees have been very generous to Clinton Township charities, excuse me. Our casual day, which actually started, you can go to the next one, started back in 2002 by Mr. Cannon to support the Rotary International Wheelchair Project, went from one time per month to once per week. To date, and I know for you all who have your form, I made a mistake and I corrected on the slide. To date, all total donations have exceeded $157,000. I believe yours says $128,000. I'm old. But if you look at the groups that we have donated to, I think the last line there, multiple Clinton Township employees that have had families that have had a loss. Talk about brothers and sisters that have helped each other. That is important. So this is a great program that the clerk too coordinates under the supervision of the administrative aide. And again, on the next one, these are some of the duties that the clerk too does. Researching the charities, making sure that they're all right, to helping to deposit the funds, to recapping the notification to the employees at the end of the year of what they gave. The next slide. Again, Clinton Township's points of pride, the Tomlinson Arboretum. I do need to say on this one, I have made a couple of errors. The clerk too really does supports the inquiries, supports ordering, doesn't do the ordering. Again, my misnomer. But I have to stop for a moment, and I have to say I'm very pleased with this program. Last year, my father-in-law came in to the supervisor's office, did not tell them who he was, spoke with the administrative aide and the clerk, and wanted to get a bench and also a tree to honor my mother-in-law, who this coming Friday will be gone a year. Came back and said, these people knew absolutely nothing about me, didn't even tell them that it was Mary West, didn't tell them anything, and I was treated with love, caring, and respect. And to this day, if you walk over here, on one side, Mr. Cannon and his family have a bench, and on the other side, there's one in honor of Mary West. And I think that it's admirable, and it's wonderful. And I just have to say thank you to the office for how they treated him. They really do a good job, and they do support a lot of the inquiries, et cetera. And I know that the administrative aide and the clerk, too, have looked at doing, 10 years ago, there was the Memorial Brick Paver Program, and they're looking to do a rededication and a 10-year memorial, and again, selling and installing more of those brick paver stones. So every single person who lives in Clinton Township who might want to commemorate a loved one has that chance. Mr. Sowerby does a wonderful blood drive in February. Thank you, Mr. Sowerby. And the clerk, the administrative aide and the clerk, too, have done a 26th annual fall blood drive. Due to some of the duties that our administrative aide has, a lot of that blood drive is done by the clerk, too. Thank you. All the way from coordinating all of the times, the dates, the times, the facility, to creating the posters, to making sure that we come up here in front of the board to put the signs up as to where that's going to be, to overseeing the volunteers of the day. So it's very, very important. And again, I have to do a personal aside here for a moment. Thank you, Mr. Sowerby, and thank you to our trustee's office, because you probably got blood for me years ago, and I appreciate it. The other duties, though, that the additional clerk two duties is that we have the AEDs and the CPR program. We have 7 AEDs, automated electrical defibrillators, in the township, known to save lives. And the clerk two has been trained to oversee, make sure that the quality and the maintenance and everything is done on those machines. There are 4 here in the Civic Center, 1 in each of the following locations: the Senior Center, Shook Roads, the Steiner Building, and DPW. She needs to make sure that everything is done to have those ready. The clerk, too, also is responsible for the coordination with the fire department for the training and certification every 2 years of the township employees in CPR and AED. Again, I have to go back and compliment Mr. Cannon's township address in January. We do have a lot of points of pride. This year we have we had the traveling wall, the wall that heals here in May. We also have the other points of pride of the 9/11 Patriots Day, et cetera. The deputy supervisor really was instrumental in pulling that whole wall that heals together, and also for the other events. However, I do know that there were certain things assigned to the administrative aide and to the clerk two as a liaison. I believe the clerk two was the liaison to the library. The administrative aide was the clerk was the liaison to the whole the parade, or the when they all came in. The escort. Thank you. Thank you. So again, couldn't be done without a partnership. A new program that we just started, which again, the deputy clerk was very, supervisor was instrumental in bringing it to us. However, this is through the Cultural Diversity Committee, and we are taking the lead, and we're working closely with Christine Sova from Welcoming Michigan. And I don't know how many times we've had to call pretty much at a last minute, and both either the clerk two or the administrative aide steps up because we've been bumped from a room over in the library. so we've been able to meet here. There have been moments when they have actually stayed after hours to allow entrance into the building, because most of the time I get here too late. Sorry. So, I keep coming back to this because we are a community of excellence, and we have to have the support of all. I know that I heard from my colleagues at the last meeting that there's not enough work for the clerk too, and that the position should be eliminated, et cetera. So what I would propose to my colleagues, next slide please, is if you look at it, there may be some future duties. This is not an exhaustive list, obviously. This is not just, this is just some examples. However, I heard from Treasurer Sowerby at a meeting when we were talking about the Kingsborough Castle Banquets facility out on Gratiot, he was a little upset that he didn't know about the trees that were taken down, and he didn't feel he could make a real good informed decision. Trustee Pearl at the last meeting stated that he didn't have backup material from Personnel Vacancy Review Committee to make a good decision on the vote for senior staff secretary, et cetera. I would propose that this person, the clerk too, could gather the information and get it not only to the trustees, which they do in a very, very good manner, but to all the board members so that there isn't so that they can read it and make that informed decision. So there isn't that problem where they're wondering what they're going to do. And then having maybe this person either attend or support the administrative aide to attend some more of these outside outreach programs, swearing-ins, ribbon cuttings, that they don't have time to do, and actually represent us at those meetings. Again, we have been stated as a community of excellence. We have also been looking to build a community of good neighbors. And with those points of pride, which have been demonstrated by you, Mr. Cannon, in a lovely speech you gave in January, and with that in mind, I'd like to make a motion to rescind the board approval of the elimination of the office clerk two position, which represents half-time in the supervisor's office and half-time in the trustee's office, and recommend as recommended at the board meeting of June 29th, 2015. Item number 8.
Support.
Okay.
Questions? Thank you, everybody, for letting me get through this without interrupting. I appreciate it.
What we will be voting on is not that item, though. You have to vote to rescind the board approval that we had before.
Right.
Is that right, Mr. Dolan?
Yeah. Rescind the board approval.
Correct. Okay. The motion is to rescind the board approval, which just leaves the matter open. At that time, you're back to where you were before that original motion had been passed.
Well, the letter that we submitted has to rescind the board approval, but to also transfer the trustee's clerk back to the trustee's office, which was the recommendation of the personal vacancy.
So there's two motions that need to be made. One is on the floor. To get to the second motion, the first one has to pass in the affirmative. Further discussion? Members of the community? Yeah.
Therese Carmella, 45744 Limerick, Macomb. So what you're saying, I have to ask through you, by rescinding the position, by rescinding the vote, you're saying that the senior staff secretary position is also not approved?
No.
You're not?
No.
You're just rescinding
that portion.
You just that of portion of it.
Elimination.
Clerk two.
Okay. I misunderstood. Thank you.
Okay.
So, Mr. Cannon, then what exactly, so what we're voting on here is to rescind the motion and...
That portion of the motion.
That portion of the motion. Then what ensues after this? Or
then
the chair to
then the
West
floor
or?
Will be open for, if it passes, which I'll be voting no, but if it passes, it then the floor would be open for another motion. If you wish to appoint a full-time person in the trustee's office, that would be the time to do it. Dean?
Just wanted to point out at the last meeting, it was brought up that we've spent approximately $500,000 in the last 2 years bringing back positions. But what wasn't pointed out was from 2007 to 2013, we cut $6 million approximately in positions. So it's not like we're adding extra $500,000 to the budget that was already inflated. We cut $6 million from that budget, okay? And I'm not saying we want to put $6 million back in. I'm just saying that it's to add $500,000 is nothing compared to the $6 million we had to cut in order to continue to give the residents their services.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Bob Hogan, 36755 Bar Street, Clinton Township. I'm not sure if this is the right time, but it most likely is. The presentation had the administrative assistant was not paid for mileage. Mm-hmm. And I don't understand why she wouldn't be paid off. Ms. West knew it, if you knew it, if the human resource manager, Mr. Smith, knew it, why wouldn't she be entitled to it, and why wouldn't she be obligated to post it and get what she's entitled to?
Well, I don't think anyone on this board requests mileage when they travel very often. It's not mandatory that you turn in mileage. It is permissible for employees who use their car for township business to turn in mileage. But she doesn't have to. She doesn't have to explain why she doesn't want to or doesn't.
Thank you.
One of the things that I would very much, and I obviously spent a lot of time on this, putting this together, and I know it was probably rather lengthy too, and I gave each one of you a copy so that you had the information in front of you. One of the things that I would like to see very much is that it is the rescind passes and that we further study whether or not maybe the four trustees get together to look at exactly what is needed in that office, without it being just something where we're going to have, I'm going to just throw it out there. It's going to be a bumperama. I mean, Jessica has some seniority. She's a union person. She's going to start bumping people. And we look at, and Mr. Smith, you probably know this off the top of your head, what is the cost of retraining? We start bumping people, that's exactly what we're doing. We're training and then retraining. And I just don't, I think we need to further study it. And I know we're all hard and fast on a lot of what we're thinking, but the Personnel Vacancy Review Committee looked at this in the best light possible, made the informed decision to actually approve the senior staff secretary along with keeping the clerk too in the position. There is a lot of work that those two people do. And I think if we either A, get to the bumperama, or B, we need to start getting rid of some of the reasons why you stood up there in January and said we have points of pride. We can't have, because we don't have the people to do it.
Many of the things, and by the way, thank you for pointing out all the good things we do in this community, including myself and other board members. I appreciated that. But what I should tell you is that many of the things that are listed under the Clerk 2's duties will still be done in the supervisor's office by the new position that will be there. So that's not going to be anything that has to be transferred to the administrative aide's position. Mr. Sowerby?
Yes. Part of what took place at the last meeting was approving in a senior staff secretary position, which is yet to be posted. Is that correct?
That's correct.
It was posted today.
No. I wanted to have Jessica Holden, who's on vacation for 2.5 weeks, which I didn't know that she was gone that long, have an opportunity to have a week to think about applying for that job. So I put off posting it until next Monday.
Okay, I got an email on it today.
But I thought she was back to work today. I thought she was gone for 2 weeks instead of 2.5 weeks.
Okay, and I didn't get anything, there was a rescinding.
I got that you pulled it back.
Yes.
I didn't get that.
I want her to have every opportunity to think about it, and she will have that opportunity.
So if I still have the floor.
Yep.
So there's still some processes that have to take place with posting of the new position, who may or may not apply for that position. I'm not sure that, I can only speak for myself, I'm not sure that I'm ready to take action either way on this issue tonight. Not that this issue shouldn't continue to be discussed and debated. So I would like to make a motion to postpone this issue that's been discussed before us here from Ms. West to the next board meeting for us to consider in 2 weeks after other processes of postings take place. And if I'm supported, I'll continue on.
Is there a support? Is there a support?
Okay.
Is there a support?
I'll support that.
Motion died for lack of support, but you can make it again.
I just supported it.
Bill, make it again.
Again, I'll make that motion to postpone for 2 weeks the item being discussed here.
But I don't understand why we have to postpone and wait. Okay, this is the trustees' department. We have two trustees that feel one way and two trustees that feel another way. When you have something of that nature, I would think it would stay the same until we could get together.
Before again, yeah.
It's only a postponement, and it can be discussed in 2 weeks, but I think that there's some other process that needs to take place here so that we have a clear understanding of the full impact of what's being requested tonight.
Part of the reason I know I'm the first motion maker and the reason I supported this is because I do feel there needs to be further discussion. If it fails and we do not rescind, and it fails, then we are basically nowhere. You know, we're zero out of luck, so to speak. So I think that Mr. Sowerby is spot on. There needs to be further discussion, and I think I think it's admirable, Mr. Cannon, that you went ahead and pulled the so that Jessica could have the chance to apply.
Not just to apply, but to think about it.
No. I understand. I agree with that. It just frustrates me that this is the trustees' department.
Well, then just vote no.
Do I have the floor?
I'm going to vote. You do, but I have.
When you wanted to reorganize your office, Mr. Cannon, you did. Mr. Sowerby, when you did things, you did. Mrs. Meltzer, you've added staff.
Mr. Reynolds, I didn't reorganize anything.
You
let him finish.
You added staff. I mean, it goes through the water department. I mean, it gets built through.
Let him finish.
It's just, this is the trustee staff, but we have the supervisor clerk, I'm sorry, not the clerk. You said that it's our staff and it should be our decision. But we have other staff members who are trying to tell us how to run our department, and it's hypocritical.
I'm voting no on the motion to postpone, so it's not a definite thing yet.
I'd like to hear from the rest of the community if there are any before.
I just have a question. When you talk about postponing, are you talking about postponing the vote on this, on the motion, or are you talking about postponing? Because the situation is, she's coming back to no job on Wednesday. So if you postpone it for 2 weeks, where does she go? She has to start.
Mr. Smith can probably elaborate on that.
Would she not start the bumping procedure at this point?
I spoke with Mr. Cannon this morning, and as my understanding, the board, when it voted last. Well, 2 weeks ago, didn't put a definite date on when that transaction would happen, correct?
Correct.
That's correct.
So it's still up in the air. Mr. Cannon agreed to postpone it.
The elimination of the position is
still up in the air.
Not dated.
Not dated.
Still up in the air.
You know, I could support that if the trustees could get together to.
We'd have 2 weeks.
I'm certainly open to that. I'm certainly open to the four of us meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Which this would be the first time we've discussed this part of it, unlike what was said at the last meeting.
I've asked this for
part
of
a year.
It.
this part of it.
I have not been asked this by you, Mr. Pearl, for a year, just so you know.
Okay.
Let's not.
No, I'm just going to, I'm just.
Let's just, we have a motion on the floor to postpone for 2 weeks. Roll call, please.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
So just so we're clear, the four trustees will meet before the 2 week period?
Yes.
Yeah.
Set that up. We have to post it.
No, it has to be a legal meeting. I just want to make sure that's what we're going to do. Then I'll vote yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
That's what the trustees want, yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes.
Okay. Move on to item 15, resolution for July 2015 drop contributions, fire chief.
Okay, this is a resolution. Do I need to read this? Okay. All right. Regarding the retirement Fire Chief John J. Shea, whereas the Board of Trustees is in receipt of a copy of correspondence from Fire Chief John Shea to the Police and Fire Pension Board dated June 30th, 2015, providing notice of Chief Shea's retirement effective August 1st, 2015, with his last day of employment being June 30th, 2015. And whereas the Board of Trustees has been advised that the retirement plan provisions as governed by Public Act 345 of 1937 as amended Act 345 provide in pertinent part that a member may retire from service upon written application to the retirement board stating a date not less than 30 days or more than 90 days after the execution and filing of the application on which the member desires to be retired. And whereas Chief Shea's notice of retirement dated June 30th with retirement effective August 1st is consistent with said plan provision, and whereas in light of the Chief Shea's last day of employment being June 30th, 2015 with retirement benefits commencing August 1st, 2015, an issue arises as to the monthly drop benefit credited to his drop account for the month of July, and whereas in consideration of the Chief's election to terminate employment effective June 30th, 2015, the Board of Trustees is desirous of clarifying and authorizing the continued credit of the applicable monthly drop benefit to Chief Shea's drop account for the month of July 2015. Therefore, be it resolved that in accordance with Section 6D of Act 345, which provides the authority to adopt post-retirement adjustments, the Board of Trustees hereby directs that Chief Shea's drop account be credited with his monthly drop benefit for the month of July 2015, and further resolved that a copy of this resolution be provided to the Pension Board and to Chief Shea.
Mr. Cannon?
Sorry.
So in simple terms, because Chief Shea was desirous of retiring and ending his employment on June 30th, but he is required by pension rules to give no less than 30 days notice before that retirement and was granted to be able to leave on June 30th instead of August 1st, he had the issue of his last month's drop, which he was due for the month of July. This makes Mr. Shea whole with that issue, but still allows him to sever his employment on June 30th. This is just a routine thing that has to be passed by this board, and the pension board already took action on this.
Move to approve. Thank you.
Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 16, approval of appointment to park ranger position.
Dear members of the board, the Department of Public Services is recommending the appointment of Mr. William Lieberman to the position of park ranger in the Facilities and Operations Division of the Public Services Department. Based on interview results and civil service testing procedures, the department is confident that Mr. Webster is well qualified and will be an asset to the township. There's an error here. As condition of employment, Mr. Webster will be required to successfully complete a background investigation and pre-employment medical examination. This is a budgeted and authorized position. Mr. Webster's hourly wage begins at $11.37 an hour as specified in the AFSCME Local 1103.12 Collective Bargaining Agreement. Upon Township Board approval, his starting date will be July 14th, 2015. Thank you for your consideration of this matter. Sincerely, William Smith, Human Resources Director. The first name mentioned should have been Mr. Webster.
Okay. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Support.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 17 has already been addressed. Item approval of the minutes of the June 15th regular Township Board meeting. Is there a motion?
Move to approve the snow amendments.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Approval of the bills?
Move to approve.
Is there a second?
Support.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion
Thank
passes.
You. We do have one public comment this evening. Ms. Nancy Goodchild.
Good evening, Nancy Goodchild, 20584 Glen Allen. I just wanted to end on a positive note. Last week's Family Fun Night, the fireworks, was awesome. I've missed the last 2 years due to being at Boy Scout camp with my son. I was amazed at the number of people that have arrived. The magnitude of how big it's gotten was awesome. The variety of the kids' activities was great. Having Big Boys and the other food vendors there was a great idea also, instead of us having to bring our own food like we normally do. The band was great, and the fireworks were awesome, okay? I loved seeing that the police and the fire presence, as well as MedStar being there. That was, you know, another positive point, feeling safe with that amount of people there. Overall, it was a great evening, and I got to share it with my family and my friends. I just say that we need to have more family-friendly events like this throughout the year, in addition to those that are coming up this month with Parks and Rec, the movie nights and the concerts in July. Thank you, Dean, and to Clinton Township Parks and Rec and everybody else that's involved in doing this and putting on such amazing events with the community. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
A motion to adjourn is in order.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
A roll call, please.
Mr. Sowerby?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Thank you. Meeting adjourned.